Welcome back to MorningLine. Today, talking juvenile crime, the prosecution of these youngsters here in Davidson County, where obviously there's a juvenile crime problem, as there are in many major cities. Khadija Babb's with us this morning. She is the prosecutor, one of them, for the DA's office here. So she's there, you know, handling these cases, and really appreciate you coming on today.
Thank you for having
me. Thank you so much for coming on. You know, so much of this, and we see it in the news every day. I was looking at some of these numbers just with regard to guns. I mean, there have been some 30 shootings in Davidson County so far this year involving juveniles. Six young people have died in these shootings. There were 176 juvenile handgun possession charges from last year, okay?
So,
teens and guns.
Yes.
And you're saying if you come across a teen who commits a crime with a gun, you're always asking for them to be held. But what, the guns?
Okay. So as far as the gun situation, I have some stats from MMPD, actually. And this is from October the 12th. And so far this year, 922 guns have been stolen from vehicles. And of more than 70% of those vehicles, more than 70% of those guns were taken from vehicles last year. 70% were taken from vehicles last year. And then 20 guns just in 1 week were stolen from cars and trucks. And most of the time, these are vehicles that are left unlocked or sometimes even left running. It says Nashville shows that 71% of the automobiles taken were easy targets because the keys were left inside or made available to the youth. 71%.
Yeah, and I've seen some of those numbers. They send that out every week, and it boggles my mind. I mean, it's like people asking to be victimized. But beyond that, you should be able to not expect to become
a
crime
victim.
That's
very true.
Would you imagine that many of these perpetrators, not all of them, of course, but as far a lot of them are teens, underage?
I would say that probably so. I don't have the stats on that, but I would say that, to me, of the youth that do get their hands on guns, they usually come from stolen vehicles, right? And while we have a right to, you know, bear arms, and no one should be a victim, regardless of whether you leave your car unlocked or regardless of, you know, whether you're running into the store to grab something, like, that's not your fault that that happened to you. But young people, brains not fully developed, see an opportunity, and we just have to, I guess, be more responsible, especially gun owners, you know.
Are they looking for guns, you think, the teens? They're looking for anything when they go in there, but if they see a gun, they're going to take it?
Oh, 100%. 100%. I mean, you have youth, for one, you have to understand that once they get a gun, that has emboldened them, right, to do even more egregious crimes. So if you don't have a gun, you're not gonna really probably be able to rob anyone. You're not gonna be able to carjack anyone. So they are going in and looking for guns. And then you have to think about money. You know, if they're on the street and they find a gun, and if you have a youth that may come from poverty, that gun may be worth $300 or $400
to them. Yes, so they can use it or sell it.
Right.
Now, you talked about the carjackings, and you said, let's talk a little bit about the cars.
Right.
And the cars. As I was saying, and we see it time and again, it's almost as though, because the cars being carjacked, they're not carjacking Volkswagen Squarebacks.
Right.
Okay? they're finding a Dodge Charger, Camaros. You know, they see these cars that they like. They'll stake it out. Some poor fella or woman walks out to their vehicle, gun to their head, give me your keys, and then they just take off.
Yeah.
What's that all? It's almost like, you've talked to these teens, or you've seen them. What's the perception in their head about this these days?
I mean, and what we have to understand that, like I said, these are youth who, they don't really have a perception about that. They're engaging in high-risk behavior. They see it as fun. It's interesting because when I first started at the district attorney's office and I heard stories about youth stealing cars, I'm like, is there a chop shop in town? Like, I couldn't understand what was going on, because that's the way that we think as adults. But their brain hasn't developed fully, and they just see it as an opportunity. I mean, it's like putting candy in front of a baby, you know. If you're running into the store and you leave your car running, and this youth can have a way to get back and forth to school, maybe they don't have to ride the bus, or maybe they can pawn it off to somebody, another youth, for $200. You just never know. And obviously, I don't get the opportunity to speak directly to the youth as it relates to this. But definitely getting stolen vehicles and having guns can lead to more egregious crimes like carjacking, because now they can get away. Now they can switch cars. So our
Is it almost like a game to them? Like, you're right, their brain's not developed. But they're taking these cars oftentimes. They're not taking them to sell them or go to a chop shop. They just want to drive them for a while. And then eventually that car will be found, dumped somewhere, right. 20 miles away.
Right.
Do you think in their head it's kind of like, you know, almost like a video game or something?
I would say maybe part of it, but maybe part of it is just feeling like you have something. You know, you might have kids whose parents don't even own a car, and they might think that, oh, well, this is a nice car. I want to see how it drives. I want to have something for myself. You know, so I'm not, like I said, I don't get to talk directly to them, but I genuinely think that the youth, they definitely don't think about it as far as long term how we do, because they're getting in the cars, they don't really have licenses, right? So it's just fun for them in a way. Mm-hmm. They're not thinking how we would logically think, like, I don't have a license, I don't know how to drive, I could get caught by the police. Even when we think about when they're evading arrests, they're not thinking the way that we would think.
I think you're right. I've been in juvenile court for hearings. Cameras aren't allowed, mm-hmm. except in very rare instances, but, you know, as a reporter, you're allowed to be in there and sit sometimes and watch. What strikes me sometimes is I'm really staring at the suspects as they go up there, and not all of them. Some of them are really upset or whatever, but a lot of them, it either looks to me like they simply have no clue what they've done, or I hate to see this, but it's like in a 14, 15-year-old, their eyes look dead. They're just like this. And I mean, it's just like completely like, you realize, and it's almost like nothing.
I think that we tend to forget, even with some of these youth, and what I've come to learn is that they've been victims of crime.
Yeah, I was going to say, how badly have they had to have been treated to get to the point where they just blank?
Right. So they've been victims of crime themselves. They've experienced poverty. They may be at a point where they don't even have hope because of the situation that they're living in. I think that people have to really understand the gravity of the situation that these youth are in. You know, we were just talking earlier about the transfer cases over the course of 7 years. And out of the 182 transfer cases over from January 2010 to June 2017, that 84% of those young people came from single parent households, and 82% were black. So I think we have a societal problem in that regard that needs to be addressed too.
Now, the 82% being African American black, I mean, is there a racial component here? You know, is it socioeconomic? How do you perceive it when the number, because I know plenty, and I've covered plenty of cases where it's a diverse bunch of youngsters, black, white, Hispanic, I mean, I see them, but you just told me 80%, that's more than even I imagined. What's going on there?
And I think it's definitely socioeconomic. I mean, it's education, it's lack of resources, it's poverty. Mm-hmm. It's single parent households. Parents don't have, you know, the resources. They're not able to supervise. It's dependency and neglect. It's resources. The number is there because black people have been affected and treated away over the course of decades, and now it's catching up to us. My supervisor, Team Lead General Stacey Miller, she always says that the criminal justice system, or the juvenile court system, I should say, is the caboose, right? So we're on a train, and all these things have happened, and now we're trying to put a stop, but we're here at the end. You know, we only have if the kids come in at 14, 15, we have a few years to try to change things around for them. So how do you fix 13 years of trauma, of poverty, you know, in 3 years, 3 or 4 years? So that's kind of what we're dealing with when they come see us.
Let's take a break on that note. When we come back, we can take a few calls. Khadija Babb's with us. She's Assistant District Attorney with the Davidson County DA's office, prosecuting these juvenile cases, and there have been a lot of them in the news. And so if you have a thought on this, the number is 737-7587. If you're on hold, stay there. We'll try to get to you right after this. Stay with us.
This is a Storm 5 weather update. For weather on the go, download the Storm Shield app.